It is a great pleasure for me today to introduce Professor Clement Lowick, an old friend of mine, I would say. You know, we did a lot of things together. First of all, by being co-founders of the European Society of Molecular Imaging, and then participating to several, let's say, network at the European level to develop imaging modalities applied in the preclinical field. Clemens is definitely a pioneer on whole body optical imaging technologies, of course, applied to mice and rat based on luminescence and fluorescence. And he is also a well-recognized pioneer in the translation of optical imaging into clinics using in intraoperative optical guided surgery to better resect tumors and metastasis at the lymph nodes. Clemens is also well known for basic studies he did that led to the clinical development of a new generation of bisphosphonates, which is like osteoporosis and metastatic bone. Clemens has been 2015. He moved at the Erasmus Medical Center in imaging in the Department of Radiology and nuclear medicine. As already mentioned before, structure molecular imaging at the European and international molecular imaging is your. Hello, we cannot hear you. Clemens?
Yeah, no, now it's okay. Okay, thank you very much, Silvio, for your nice words. And it's a pleasure to present and to see you all, guys. And today I'm going to talk about state-of-the-art new optical imaging tools. And I especially would like to draw most of the attention to all the new possibilities of bioluminescence imaging. I think due to the time, I will not have time to go into the more clinical fluorescence guided surgery. Also, because we're working on some new things that we are patenting, so I cannot present that at the moment. Very exciting new developments. So, so I'm working in the Erasmus Medical Center. It's one of the biggest academic hospitals in Europe. So we have 23,000 employees and a budget of 1.4 billion per year. It also includes the Children's Hospital, which is one of the most specialized hospitals in the Netherlands, and also the second cancer center in the Netherlands, Daniel de Hoed, who was separate and the other side of the town is now also integrated into the hospital. We have completely new buildings. And so and last year, the official opening was with our king, and the whole building was 1 billion. So we have a lot of facilities. So what is nice is that we also have a huge amount of one of the biggest imaging centers where we have all the different techniques, as you can see, from ultrasound to PET SPECT. We also bought, as you can see here, we bought the Vector, which is a SPECT PET machine, which can do CT, but also has an optical imaging system in it. So it's the most advanced system where you can do all the different technologies. We also bought the Vectra, where we can, on tissue slides, do eight different colors. And also I got a big grant to, so I also got the newest multispectral optoacoustic tomography system from iTheron. So we are extremely well equipped, and everything is in one facility. So you can hop from one room to the other to do the imaging with your mice. So this is the group, the optical molecular imaging group. And actually our mission is to develop new optical imaging tools and probes for preclinical research and translation to the clinic. And I must say, I'm very happy that my right hand, actually Laura Mezzanotte, who I recruited from Bologna, she is really, I always call her the queen of bioluminescence, and she is driving all the new technologies. And I will talk about it a lot in this presentation. Then we have two very bright young students, Natasha Kaspar and Giorgia Sambito, that are busy now with imaging immune cells, specifically because now immune therapy is very hot. We are focusing much of our attention now to image immune cells. Furthermore, we have Arno, who is actually a veterinarian and actually has a camera system in his facility, I will show you. And also with Fiebeke, also a veterinarian, we actually test our probes first in dogs, because that's easier than to go directly to humans. And that's really, I will show you how it works. Then I have Roizin and Shintan. They work on pancreatic cancer imaging, also in combination, looking at the tumor, but also at the tumor microenvironment. Then I have Siwan Deng and Angela Costagnoli. They are from an Italian university. We're visiting, and they have developed nanoparticles containing fluoro-19. And Siwan, she's a chemist, and we are now the ones which can have the highest amount of fluoro-19 in the nanoparticles. There's a nice trick to it. And so we can do also now MRI, and we are targeting them to macrophages because we want to see the tumor macrophages. And then I have Kranti and Mark. They work on my newly developed necrosis probes. I also had an appointment until last year. It's ended because of the COVID with the famous Professor George Kukos and Doug Hanahan, the man from the hallmarks of cancer. And actually, they have built a completely new institute, Agora Institute for Translational Cancer Research, where George is one of the directors together with Doug. And I was appointed there for 1.5 years. And I worked closely with Elena Dubovskaya, who actually now has her, she got divorced, so now he has her maiden name again, Lena Gaun, who is also an expert on chemistry and developing all kinds of new contrast agents for bioluminescence imaging. So our research focus is, like I told you, to develop new tools for bioluminescence and near-infrared imaging. And I will show you today how we can now image in two colors, because the old-fashioned way was to just have luciferase and you just measure the light that's now. But now we can, just like with fluorescence, we can do actually kind of multicolor in vivo imaging of processes at the same time and get more information out of it. That's very exciting. And I will show you how we have used this technology also for T cells. Like Sylvia already mentioned, we also developed a lot of probes when I was still in Leiden, where we have a whole new generation of near-infrared dyes. We also developed new dyes, which you just put to a tumor-targeting molecule. And then, as you can see, this was done here in a dog. And you see beautifully when we operate the dog, you see the tumor and just resect it. This is an example. So actually, I got the newest camera from the US, the Solaris, which actually is not in my lab, but it's actually in the oncological clinic for domestic animals in Gouda from the famous cheese. And Arno is there, one of the owners. He's a young guy who is interested in science. And actually there is also, what is nice is that if you want to test it in dogs, you actually need only more or less the informed consent of the owner. And then you can try it on the animals. Of course, we always get ethical permission, because we wanted to do it properly. What you can see here for us this year also, you can see very nicely how we can dissect and see the small tumors, and we can remove them. And then once we know that it's safe and works nicely in dogs, then we do it also in the clinic in Rotterdam. We have also camera systems now and in Leiden. I also have developed one of the new dyes which specifically binds to necrotic tissue, which is very exciting because necrosis only occurs in pathological situations. So it's never, if I inject this probe into you, and you're healthy, nothing will happen. It's cleared very rapidly. But if you have some kind of damage of dead cells, it will light up. So here you see a mouse which had a myocardial infarction. And when we inject the probe, even from the outside, you can see that the heart lights up because the infarct site has necrosis. And then we took out the heart, sliced it to the middle, and put it on the near infrared scanner. And you see here the site where the heart has the necrotic dead tissue. So it's very nice to image infarcts. We also did this in brains and in other areas. Now we are going to the clinic with this with burns, because in burns you need to remove all the dead tissue before you can do a transplantation, or else the tissue will be rejected. So this is something we're working on. What is exciting also is that 80% of all tumors will develop a necrotic core, and people are not aware of that. So actually, that a necrosis is something which is not found in a healthy human being. So necrosis is actually one of the best tumor markers you can imagine. And what is nice is that the more necrosis you have, the more aggressive the tumor is, because the tumor becomes necrotic because it grows, the rapid growth, the blood vessels cannot keep up with them, and you get a central necrosis. So it's a beautiful marker for also looking at the aggressiveness of tumors. And so that's what we're doing. So we see that aggressively growing tumors have much more necrosis. And so that's a beautiful marker for aggressiveness. And what is even more exciting, that's why we want to bring to the clinic, is that if we treat the mice with chemotherapy, already within 24 hours, we see that there is an increase in the amount of necrosis, and we can detect this. Of course, we can, in humans, we cannot use light, because if the tumor is very deep, so we have coupled a DOTA to it, and we can beautifully now see it with, we just published this, and we can see with great activity with PET CT, we can measure and calculate exactly what the increase is. So instead of waiting three to 6 weeks before you see something on MRI or CT, volumetric, now with the PET CT, we see within 24 hours if a chemotherapy is working or not. So that's really exciting. That would be very, very important for the clinic. So now I would like to tell you all the story about the next era. So there's a revolution going on in bioluminescence field. Many people are not aware of that because everybody just thinks about the old-fashioned luciferase that you use, you transfect cells, you see light. But I will show you what we have done over the last 10 years. So what you see here, this is a construct that we made, and together with people from Philips, we in Eindhoven, we published this paper right in 2015, where we have this construct. You see, if you use it and you transfect breast cancer cells, you see beautifully that you can follow the cells in vitro with GFP. When we inject it here and you get the bone metastasis, this is breast cancer that metastasizes the bone, you see there's metastasis there. And we can also, using HSV-TK, we can also do SPECT imaging, and we can see co-localization, and we see beautifully have different options to follow different processes there. So Laura and my group, she made actually also the first fusion proteins. This is one of the first infrared proteins, which excite at 720 nanometers. So the penetration of light is very deep. And directly fused to LUG-2, that was the best luciferase that was present at that time. And what is nice is that the ERFP, not only is highly red fluorescent, but also has good optoacoustic properties. So you can also use optoacoustic imaging to do this. This was Laura transplanted stem cells in the brain for treating strokes. What you can see here, if you have 1 million cells or 100,000 cells or even 1,000 cells, we can still pick it up when we transplant them in the brain. So 1,000 cells can still be seen. And if you look now at fluorescence, you can see actually that it's tenfold less sensitive because the light has to go in and has to come out with fluorescence, whereas with bioluminescence, the light only comes out when you inject your substrate. But what is nice is that you can see that it beautifully co-localizes with the signals you see with bioluminescence. So afterwards, so you do your measurements in vivo, and afterwards you can take out all the tissues and do the examination on histology using the RFP. So this is the more exciting ones, which I will elaborate more on, is that we have created a construct which is an inducible promoter and a constitutive one. So all the cells will have the click beetle green, which emits at 540. But when an inducible promoter, in our case, it was the T-cell mouse, then when T-cells become active, they also have a red light. So when you can see in the mouse, when there is red light, it means the T-cells are activated, which is very important because the whole immune therapy is based on activated T-cells. So a little bit more about people who are not familiar with bioluminescence. Of course, you have the famous firefly and click beetles. They have more or less the same emission at around 620. So this is the firefly, but also click beetle. They have overlapping spectra, but they have different genes. And then we have the more aquatic ones, the ranilla from the sea pansy, and these gaussia, these small animals. It's also very, and especially the nanoluc is extremely bright. So it's 10,000 fold more photons you generate with the nanoluc compared to firefly, but the light is blue. So the penetration of light, you see blue light penetration is only 1 to 2 millimeters, whereas red light penetrates about 1 centimeter. So that's a disadvantage. So you get enormous amount of light with nanoluc, but the light is blue. So why is this now a new revolution going on? Because now we have mutated and all kinds of luciferases. So we have emission at different wavelengths. And this can actually be enhanced by generating chemically novel luciferin analogs that makes the binding differently, which results in wavelengths at higher wavelengths, which gives you not only sometimes enhanced light emission, but also more sensitivity because it's more in the red and near infrared, which penetrates deeper. Together with Elena, she is an expert on caged lucens substrates, which is really exciting. I will give you two examples of that. Now I think almost 24 different enzymatic or proteolytic activity, and even glucose uptake, amino acid uptake. We can follow this by bioluminescence. And that's really big. And also big companies like Novartis are very interested in this because we can also follow uptake, for instance, from of antibodies and all kinds of other things. What is interesting now, also now these the newest camera systems, the EMCCDs, what we discovered actually is because the old-fashioned ones have a peak, which is maximally around 700. But so the sensitivity is more around 600. But these new cameras, they have much further sensitivity, and especially the what we have discovered also is that the bioluminescence of luciferases has a big shoulder at higher wavelengths, which penetrates deeper. So that's also something which contributes to much more sensitive and deeper imaging. So this is the reaction you have normally. You see here luciferin, and then you have if you have luciferase, the luciferin will be transformed in oxaluciferin and will generate light. The light will be in vivo orange or red. In vitro, the light is more green orange, and in vivo the light is orange red around 600 nanometers. So there's a difference between this, also temperature dependent, at room temperature, the light is more, as you can see here, greenish yellow, and in vivo it's orange red because emission is at higher wavelengths. Here you have the Renilla and Gaussia. They use cilentrazine as a substrate and generates blue light. And I told you this is the famous star on the horizon is Nanoluc. It's the smallest luciferase. It's a very small gene. And it uses fumarazine as a substrate, and it generates enormous amounts of light, so 10,000 fold higher than these guys. And I will show you how you can use this. So the disadvantage of blue light is that the penetration is not very good. So what the group in the US did is they actually coupled the Nanoluc to a fluorescent protein, the PSIOF FP1. Which is orange red. So when the Nanoluc, so it's actually a kind of bread. So the energy of the Nanoluc, the emission of light of the enormous amount of photons is transduced to the fluorescent molecule, and you get fluorescent light out at around 600. So you can change blue light into red light. We have tried it also, but I must say it's tedious, and what we see with our new luciferases, this is for us not a good option. What is very exciting, and I think a lot of people are not aware of it, is that the Nanoluc, you can actually, if you cut off the last 11 amino acids, or you make a peptide of amino acids, and you have the other part of the Nanoluc, which is 165 amino acids, when they meet each other, they will conjugate back together. So they will reconstitute. So actually it's a click chemistry. So if you have the large bit, and the small bit, when they put them together, they immediately will, extremely efficiently will reconstitute. So actually Promega is selling these kits because you can do all kinds of protein-protein interaction, because if protein A with the large bit is coupled with and finds protein B with a small bit, you can reconstitute and you get light. We have used this, I will show you, to image also viruses like COVID. So what was one of the big breakthroughs that we did, and we published this in Nature Communications together with the Promega group. So actually what they did, they took this click beetle rat, which normally you can see here has a peak at 660, like the normal luciferase, LUC2, you can see it here. What Mary did, she just randomly mutated the molecule. And actually she also developed different naphthyl luciferins. And what you see with the naphthyl luciferins, that actually the when they bind to the click beetle red mutant that we found in the screen, you see the emission now is at 740. So it's really in the near infrared. So the penetration of light is much deeper. And what was also very exciting is that the CB red 2 mutant is also more thermal stable, because this is LUC2. You can see here, if the LUC2 is starting to be expressed, then you see that the enzyme is thermal label at 37 degrees. After 5 hours, the enzyme is gone. Whereas the CB-RET is still active. And it's probably also why we get much more light and much better effects in vivo. And you can see here, if we take now D-luciferin, so the normal substrate that we use, you can see here that you get, and the injected cells by tailwind injections, they will home to the lungs. You get lung accumulation, and you can see here, there's about 4 times more light when we use the click beetle 2 mutant that has been codon optimized. So this is already using your standard luciferase, you get 4 times more light. What is actually exciting is also what you can see here, because everybody who works with bioluminescence know that if you have a black mouse, it's a horror, because the dark hair and the skin will absorb a lot of light. So we injected tumor cells here in the mouse. We didn't shave it. And already you can see, because the amount of light you can see here on the right, you see about 8-fold higher amount of light that you get in vivo in a black mouse if you use exactly the same cells but use different. If you've used the LUG2 or instead of the clickable rat. What is also interesting, if you use the new substrate, which emits light at 740, the amount of photons is less. But look, if you look at it, the signal, it's much more localized, because normally you see this is a kind of blob of light, because you get at lower wavelengths, you get a lot of scattering of your photons. And at 740, the scattering is much lower, and you see very precise localization. So the localization, actually we improve the signal resolution tremendously. This was shown also in our Nature Communications paper 2 years ago, where we have put cells in the brain. We did it stereotactically, so we know exactly that it's at 3 millimeters depth in the brain, and we use then the CBRET with our optimized with DLUG, and we used it with our new substrate. When we use DLUG, you see again that you get this blob of light. But when we use the new substrate, we saw suddenly, because this was done after 5 days, we saw two signals. So this is done with the 3D imager we have for bioluminescence. So it's interesting, because we know that what happens in these 5 days, that these cells, these stem cells, can migrate to the to another location in the ventricle, to the third ventricle. So the cells here, they are injected, and then they start migrating to the ventricle. So actually, for the first time, we see very high resolution bioluminescence 3D imaging in the brain using this new mutated luciferase with the new substrate. And beginning, people didn't believe us, so in the paper we had to do histology. And the nice thing is that this construct also contains GFP. So we have not only luciferase, but also GFP. So we made sections for the brain. And actually, as you can see here, that you see a population of cells here, and you see here a population of cells in this side. So these are the two locations we could find back using the GFP, and then proving that indeed we were talking about two populations of cells that have migrated. At the same time that we published it, and this exciting paper appeared in 2018, the same time, what they did, they took actually the luciferase, the normal luciferase, and randomly mutated it. And they found a mutant with 28 mutations, which had tremendous increased photon emission. So, and also what is nice is that what they actually did, because there was already a new substrate called Acalumin, HCl. And actually what they did, they mutated it and in conjunction with this substrate. And then you can see that if you use this substrate and with this new mutant, you see enormous amounts, about 1,000-fold more signal when you use the Acalumin with the Acaluc. We tried it also, we compared it recently, and actually it's not as spectacular as they have put it in this science paper, because what people do usually is that they use a substrate concentration which is suboptimal for the normal luciferase, and then if they compare it with there, you see this huge difference. But most of the times, these substrates, you cannot give too high amount of them, because then it becomes insoluble. Whereas with the normal, the luciferin, you can go very high up, it's not toxic, and then you can even outcompete. If you give high enough substrate, you can still get the same amount of light shown here. But what is exciting is, and if you go further here, what they did also, they injected one cell in the Tainville, two cells, three cells, and 10 cells. So they made dilutions. And you can see here, of the five animals they injected, two of them, they could find back one cell that they injected into the lung. So here they found two cells, and here there is a nice graph where they show that the amount of cells, even one cell, you could image deep in the lung. This is really spectacular. Even more spectacular that they used monkeys, where they injected stem cells in the brain of the monkey at 4.8 millimeters. They injected the acalumin, and they could find a beautiful signal. And here, this is actually a movie. If you go to the paper, there is a movie This is a freely moving monkey in the dark, and you can see here that you can follow it, and you can see even over a long time of period, even after 5 months, you see still that the cells in the brain transplanted are present. So this is something, especially for neuroscience, very exciting. So let's move gears now to the cage luciferans. So what Elena did actually is actually she has a caged luciferin substrate, because this caged form does not fit into the pocket of luciferase. But when this is cleaved off, it frees the luciferin and you get a signal. So she did it for all kinds of enzymes that are able to cleave. So the galactosidase, the caspase, the H2O, the beta-lactamase. And this one is exciting because this is the substrate for caspase 3, which is involved in apoptosis. So here, what you have, so you have the substrate with a ZDEVD in front of it. So you have a small peptide in front of this. So you have coupled it here on this side. And when you inject it, it's taken up by the cells. And only when caspase 3 is active, so that means there is apoptosis, it's cleaved off and you see light. So this is what Bang Wen in my lab did, actually. So we took the cells and here we have the normal luciferin. So we gave this gambogic acid, which Bang Wen liked because it's a Chinese, a very potent Chinese compound, which is a natural compound, which is highly anti-cancer. But you see that you can kill the cells by apoptosis. Because if you give it, you see this is the live cells, and the more of the gambogic acid you give, the cells start dying. Oh, sorry. But if you now give the other substrate, the ZDEVD, you see an increase. Here you have much less cells, which have a much stronger signal because the DEVD is cleaved off because these cells activate caspase 3. So what you actually then do is you just divide these two on over each other. And then you get these kind of nice graphs. You see here, this is the caspase activity, and this is the cell death that you measure with it. So very simply, you can now very rapidly with this cage substrates can measure apoptosis using caspase 3. So Laura, when she was still a postdoc in my lab, and she published this also, because we'd also did it in vivo. So here you have the total amount of tumor, which is the status of the tumor, and you can see here that it doesn't change over time. This is zero time, 4 hours, and 24 hours, and here you can see that here they're equal. When we give now TNF, if we give celastrol, which is a NF kappa B blocker, and then you see that the tumor starts to become apoptotic, and you see the light. Here changes, there's no change there in the total amount of cells, but you see here that the caspase signal is increasing. So you can calculate very nicely, non-invasively, the amount of apoptosis in your tumor. So then Elena, she worked in Stanford and in Berkeley, and in Berkeley there works the famous Caroline Bertozzi. I was thinking she will get the Nobel Prize one of these days because she's a brilliant scientist. And she actually discovered that you can use the Staudinger reaction. Sorry, it should be an E. Because the Staudinger reaction, you have a phosphine group, which will react with a free azide. And if this happens, so if you have the phosphine group coupled to your luciferin, and you add any molecule with a free azide, then what will happen is that the phosphine will react with the azide and releases the luciferin substrate. So it's actually a bioorthogonal click reaction. So what she did actually, Elena, is that she injects the caged luciferin with the phosphine group. You inject it, it's taken up by all the cells, and it's intracellularly. And then if you give a metabolite, whatever it is, it can be an antibody, it can also be, I will show you, glucose. Then the glucose, after 24 hours, you inject this, it will be taken up by the cells. And only the cells where the metabolite is taken up, the luciferin is cleaved, is released by the Staudinger reaction, and you will emit light. So here, this is shown also for this paper she published in Nature Methods, 2019. And what you have here, so she in the paper, you see that she has made about 10 different glucose molecules. And actually, this one is interesting because this one was the best. It's a hexene ring with fluors on it, and it has a free azide here. So if you first inject, again, you cage luciferin, and if you then look, if there's light, there's no light. But if you now inject the glucose, which is called GAS4, with this molecule, which has this azide, you see all the sites where you have glucose uptake. And if you give an excess amount of glucose, you see the light can be completely competed away. And you can see it here also. So now you can do actually what all these people are doing with FDG, we can do with light. And it's much cheaper. And I will show you also much more easy to work with. So you can see here that over time, you see there's a nice uptake of glucose. And you can completely, if you have no substrate, then you, of course, you will, don't see it. And what is nice, again, you can completely block it with excess of glucose. Then what Elena did is that she knocked out the glucose transporter, which is known and highly active in this breast cancer. So this is the tumor. This is the she did this in Stanford with her friends. You see here the FDG uptake. And here you see if you have the knockout, you see the signal is much lower. And you can see here there is a lot of spread in the different animals you measure. But you see nicely that indeed the average of the tumors which have the knockout take up less glucose. If you do now the same now with the substrate instead of the FDG PET, it takes a lot of time, it's expensive, you have to work quickly because of the short half-life. You see here, she injects the substrate, the 4-gas, and then you see beautifully that the signal here, you see red is very strong, you see red is strong, and here more bluish. So the knockout has less. And if you look at it now, at all the mice she measured, look at the standard deviation is very small. So it's much more precise. You have much more variation in the glucose uptake with, if you use PET SPECT than when you use this new bioluminescent substrate. And actually now, to make the long story short, when I was there, we have now all these enzymes we can measure. We can measure now with the Staudinger reaction. So beta galactosidase, sulfatase, nitroreductase, caspases, carboxyl transpeptidase. And we can measure mitochondrial main potential, mitochondrial toxicity, H2O2, H2S. Glucose, glutamine, free fatty acids, peptides, proteins, antibodies. This is very interesting for the industry because if you want to have something which should be internalized or not, you want to know if it is internalized or not. So you can add one of these two, and when they're together, you will see the light. So this is about the caged substrates. This will open up a whole world of possibilities because you just measure the total amount of cells, but normally luciferase or our new substrate. And then you have the caged substrates to look at enzyme A, B, D, whatever you have in your toolbox. And it's kind of a playground now where you can have your toolbox with the different enzymes you would like to measure. It's all possible now. But we are always want to drive it to the limits. So our holy grail would be that we can see two different colors at the same time with the same substrate. So you don't have to inject, get a peak, wait until the peak is gone completely, which takes about half an hour to an hour, and then you inject the next substrate. So can we have two enzymes with different colors but using the same substrate? And that also, that both emit in the near infrared. Because if you have one in the near infrared and the other one not, the other one, which is not in the near infrared, will be quickly, you will lose the signal because there's more absorption. So this was a big challenge, and especially Laura, who works closely together with Mary Hall. We gave Mary the assignment, can you make a click beetle green and optimize it with the new substrate where the light will be in the near infrared. Wow, that would be really something special. And actually, Georgia, she's really a fantastic, clever PhD student, originally from Sicily, and she did the work. So what we want, as I told you, that we have already the Click Beetle Red, which emits at 740. You can see it here. So can we have one which also emits at 660? Because the Click Beetle Green normally emits at 540. So it's more than 100 nanometers in wavelength difference. So what she did actually is that she mutated the luciferase, and these are the luciferase we have now. So we see the different colors we have, and also these are the different substrates we have. So what Mary did, she mutated the Click Beetle Green, and to make a long story short, we have here the old-fashioned Click Beetle 99 mutant, which we have put on one, and you see that even with normal luciferin, you see a fourfold higher emission. But if you use this substrate, which is the same as one we looked for Click Beetle, it's 14-fold higher. So with that new substrate and mutation, we get much more light. And as you will see, it's also now at 580, but in vivo, it's at 660. So here, okay, let's skip this, but what you can see here is Click Beetle Green is much higher levels with D-luciferin. And if you use a new substrate, it's the other way around, the Click Beetle Red is higher. But what is more interesting is here is that if you use normal luciferin, the Click Beetle Green is even more potent than the Click Beetle Red, which is already improved. But what you see in vivo, if you use our new substrate, that you get a peak at 660 and at 740. And you say, okay, but they are still too close together. But what is new now, of course, in the field, and everybody, and Sylvia knows this very well, is called spectral mixing. So what you do actually, if you have, there's an algorithm that can recognize the specific wavelengths of a specific luciferase. So luciferase A has a certain wavelength of emission, and also the other one has a wavelength of emissions. You put it into the algorithm, and then based on the different characteristics of the wavelengths, the algorithm can completely separate the two signals, which is called spectral mixing. It's a huge revolution also in microscopy. So spectral mixing, you can now have 50 different colors of red, which you cannot distinguish by eye, but by these algorithms, you can distinguish them. So what we did here, you can see it here. We injected cells which express Click Beetle Green and also Click Beetle Red. And then you can see here very nicely that if you use the green filter here, you see here, and so this is 660, you see that if we put still more of the red cells to it, so we mix the cells together, you see that the green, you see 100%, you see a big signal, and the less you have less signal because the red cells we cannot pick up. And here you can see that if you use the red filter, you see here there's no red cells here, and you see an increase there. This is also nicely depicted. So you see a decrease of the green light, the green Click Beetle Green, and an increase in the Click Beetle Red. So we can completely separate the two signals in vivo. So this is going to be a revolution, because now it means that we have emission at 660 and 740, so very deep penetration. We have strong emission of photons, and we can separate the two colors completely. So these tools are now ready for everybody in the world to make new transgenics that express different colors, like I showed you with the T-cell mouse. What is also interesting, that we also can combine, because I told you the Arcaluc that was published in Science is also a very strong combination with their Arcalumine. So here we have cells expressing Arcaluc with the Arcalumine HCl and the Click Beetle Green. You can see it here. It doesn't react at all with Arcalumine, whereas the Arcalumine strongly gives it a strong photon emission with Arcalumine, which you can see here. This is in vitro. And the other way around, when we give our substrate, the naphthyl luciferin, you see that the Arcalumine does not like it, but the Arcalook doesn't like it, but our ClickBeetle Red loves it, and ClickBeetle Green also. So here you can also make a couple, again, using different substrates, but now you have almost, you have no light with one substrate for one color, and you have no light with the other substrate. So this was also shown very nicely in vivo. You have to believe me that you can see nicely that you can separate. You see here the 700 and the 660. You can separate again these two signals completely. So to conclude this is that we have a novel dual near-infrared ClickBeetle luciferase system for semi-quantitative deep tissue whole body imaging. And you only have to inject one substrate and you get two colors. So it means that you don't have to wait long and the animals have to suffer for a long time because you have to keep them under anesthesia for a long time. No, here you inject, 10 minutes later you have the two signals and you're done. We can also use two different substrates if you want that, because they both give very strong signals, and the signals are completely separate because the two substrates do not cross-react with the mutant. And what I will show you is the last 5 minutes of my talk. We can also now couple it with the NanoLook, and we have found also a new substrate for it, which is in vivo much better. So this was done by Natasha Gaspar. She also is a PhD, clever PhD in our group. And actually what we did, we tested all kinds of new substrates for NanoLook. And because what you see here, the NanoLook, it gives you blue light. And what is the problem is that fumarasin, that is the normal substrate for the enzyme, is not very soluble. So you cannot inject high amounts of substrate to get more light. And so we tested all the different ones. And what you can see in the end is actually what, if you look in vitro, you see here that the hikarazin, here the red one, hikarazin 003, from made by the group in Paris, you see it gives the highest amount of photons. It's really very strong substrate for NanoLook in vitro. It's the best one in vitro. And actually you see that the fluorhimerazine is the one which is the poorest in vitro. And what you can see also again, that it's extremely sensitive. You can pick up one cell, three cells. So it's extremely sensitive because you generate enormous amount of photons again. But now going to in vivo, actually fluorofumarazin is much more soluble and also has a better cell penetration activity. So when you give it in vivo, that you see that actually it outperforms all the others. And you see the kinetics is very quick. So after 1 minute already, usually we measure after 1 minute, you see that it's about tenfold higher than the hikarazin 003 and the fumarazine, which is the normal substrate. So now we can have 10 times more light in vivo using the NanoLook with this new substrate. Then we also compare it because, as I told you, the light penetration of luciferase is about 660. This is still at 540. Even though here you see that the Arcalook, if you inject cells, a few thousand cells in the tail vein, you see that you can see it in the lungs, but still we can also still see it, although a little bit to lesser degree, also depending on the kinetics, we can still see it also with our new substrate, because we can give higher amounts of substrate, which means that you get more light. So conclusion of this part is that hikarazin and fluorazin are giving you much higher signals in vitro. Fluor gives you higher substrate loading and improved optical imaging sensitivity in mice. And also fluorazine enables deep tissue imaging at NanoLook. So we have now possibility to combine this NanoLook fluorazine with the ones I told you. So we can have a triple color imaging. So this is the very final part about imaging of viruses. As I told you, the nanobit system, that's going to be one of the big things in biochemistry. Again, if you have the 11 amino acids with the longer, the large bit with the high bit, they will reconstitute. And if you give the substrate, you get light, as you show here. So we are interested because I'm working together with Laura in the national the consortium of oncolytic viruses, and our task was to make new systems where we can follow viral infections, and especially now with COVID, it's interesting. We are very close now, and we have already the virus expressing the nanoluc, and we are now starting the first in vivo experiments, as Laura is doing this with our viral group. But I was more interested in the oncolytic viruses because, like I told you here, the pandemic, it makes us realize that we need to have better tools to really quickly screen for new drugs. Because if we injected the mice and they light up, and we see the light goes down with a certain treatment, that would speed up drug discovery enormously. But the oncolytic virus therapy is exciting because it can specifically infect tumor cells and kill them. And what is also interesting is that many viruses, if you want to transfect them with GFP or whatever, they throw it out. They don't like large insertions. So if you have something which is small, they tolerate it much more. So what is the basis of oncolytic viruses? So we use the Delta 24 RGD and hybrid GFP construct. And this is a kind of adenovirus construct, which has the RGD sequence in it. And it it also has the small part of the nanoluc in it with GFP. So normally, an oncolytic virus will if it goes into the cell, it will be eradicated and the cell stays healthy. But in the tumor cell, I have no time to explain it extensively, but oncolytic viruses specifically can replicate in tumor cells and kill the cell. And this is now used in the clinic. So this one is used also already in glioma in our clinic. And I was really excited to see that already one patient with the glioma was cured by this treatment, by the group of Clemens Derve from the neurosurgery. So what we did actually here again, we used PC3 cells because we know that PC3 cells, the prostate cancer cells, are also can also be infected by this virus. And we can see very nicely that how many viruses you should give. And you see here, if you have a mode of infection of 4, you see fantastically that all the cells have been infected by the virus and they light up. So the cells have the large bit. The virus has this very tiny 11 amino acid extra part. And when they infect, the two parts come together inside the cell and they will give light. So we did the same now here. We took the PC3 cells, the prostate cancer cells, expressing the large bit. So the tumors have these. And when you inject then the virus, in this case, it was the oncolytic virus, it will, when it infects, it will reconstitute in the tumor and you should see it lighting up. And I told already Silvio that we're working with this viral science group from our hospital. They are one of the leading groups now in the whole coronavirus treatment. And they have an IVIS behind the barrier because it's really restricted. You have to dress up and you have nothing is allowed to do there. And so we have to, when we do the imaging, we have to put the animals into this specific box they made, a glass box. So there's no contact possibility, and we can do the imaging, rapid imaging in the IVIS, and then go out again and get completely changed and disinfected. So you need to have this specific options to do this, and we can do this. So what was exciting that Natasha and did it, and what we saw, you see there's variation amount of signals. So we have some mice which have high signal, and even up to 42 days, we can follow the viral infection of the oncolytic virus. So the virus is actually infecting and replicating the tumor. And this one, as you see, there's a low signal, and you see that after 10 days, it goes down. But what was interesting, that the mice with the high infection, you can see here, with the high infection here, they have a much slower tumor growth. Here we have to kill all the ones with the low infection rate already after 20 days because the tumors are too big and we are not allowed to let them grow beyond a certain size. So we have to kill the animals. But here, all the treated mice with a high infection rate, they survive longer because the tumors grow much slower. And we also took out the tumors and we did a histology staining with the GFP. And you see beautifully that the tumor cells are highly infected with the oncolytic virus. So this is very promising because now we can learn more about the biology and the timing and see if we can increase and the tumor killing and infection of these oncolytic viruses. So the final conclusion here is that the nanobits can be used to detect and quantify oncolytic virus infections in vitro and in vivo using the new hydrofluorescein, which gives you about tenfold better light. And also what is nice is, of course, that you can in vitro, because now we can, the idea is that we have the in vitro COVID virus and also this oncolytic virus, and we can see if certain treatments can eradicate these viruses, especially the COVID virus. So in vitro, and then when it works, you can see if this also works in vivo. So I think that the tools we have generated, not only in the field of cancer, where we have the necrosis probe to see efficacy of therapy, but also the image-guided surgery probes that we brought to the clinic, where we can better resect tumors, that now also that we can image viral infections in small animals. So we can also do it in hamsters, because we know that hamsters and ferrets, we can image that with the imager we have, that they are good models to study COVID infection and screen for new drugs. So here I would like to end without saying that Laura, I really, I'm preparing her to be my successor when I leave with pension. And Laura is really a fantastic scientist who is actually behind all these new developments. She's very on top of it. And also Georgia and Natasha, who worked as PhD students on this. Kranti works on the necrosis, but also helped with the studies. And Janto is our technician for imaging. Elena, where we did all the collaborations with the cage substrates. These people are involved in the oncolytic virus studies. Our friends from EMC colleagues, sorry, this is wrong. Mary, Lance, Thomas, and Jay, Monica, and Joel from Promega, who we closely collaborate with, and they make all these mutants for us and in close collaboration, and also discuss all the new substrates that can be made. So thank you for your attention. And if you have any questions, I'm welcome to answer them.
Thank you, Clemens, for this very interesting presentation that show us how, the huge progress in this field. I'm really impressed by the sensitivity enhancement that could be raised. Unfortunately, you have to leave. Personally, yes. I ask Joanna or yes. Marianna to take over and yes. to chair the session and to see for the question that yes. I think they will come.
I hope to speak to you soon.
back to you, in particular, yes. as far as concern the last part of your talk concerning the application in the field of infectious disease.
Yes.
Thank you very much again.
Thank you, and hope to see you soon in life, Silvio.
Thank you.
Okay, I think I'll take over the Q&A session. Do we have any questions from the audience for Professor Lovick? Anybody? If you can, either you can just unmute and ask the question or put that in the chat as well. Maybe if, to give people a minute to think about this, I can get started. I was very impressed by the work that seemed to go down to almost the cellular resolution. So what do you yes. think the resolution limits are for these techniques? So, and pushing this further, where do you see this going?
Yeah, it used to be several hundreds of microns, but now it's really going down to several microns. So as you could see in the brain, that we could really distinguish very close distances already from each other with the new substrate. So I think the resolution, as I showed, really improved at least 10 to maybe even 50 fold.
Yeah, that's super impressive, that improvement. Do you think it will be possible to do subcellular resolution in the future? Maybe in neurons or?
Yeah, what is nice about the nanoleak, as I told you, is blue light, but there are so many photons coming off that even if you have it in under the microscope, there, so you can see it. And so now Laura is busy also doing single cell luciferase analysis. And especially now with these new substrates, we hope because we can even get a subcellular resolution. So that's something we are busy with.
That would be a huge
another breakthrough, yeah.
Yeah.
But it's already to do it in single cells. We can beautifully see single cell activity.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I mean, that's already a very big deal.
Exactly.
Yeah. We have a question in the chat from Corinne. Do you want to unmute and ask the question yourself?
Yeah. Did you hear me?
Yeah.
Yes, we can hear you. Please go ahead.
So, first of all, thanks a lot for this very nice talk, Clemens. I have a question about some future project. Project using fluorescence imaging in a second near infrared window.
Yes.
Because you speak about improving cyanol-to-noise ratio using infrared BLI.
Yes, we will have a near infrared 2 camera system. And we also busy now. We have some probes where we have good near infrared 2 signals. So, for instance, for image guided surgery, I think the resolution and the will be really improved, but also the sensitivity, because we can measure now at the 1100, 1200 nanometers with the near infrared 2 camera system. And our probe can be visualized with that. So, we have a new dye, which I cannot elaborate on yet, that fulfills this criteria.
Mm-hmm.
So also for the fluorescence, we will be able to get better resolution and higher sensitivity because we can measure in the near infrared 2 window.
Yeah. And do you think that at that time, the most difficult is coming from the chemistry of the fluorescent probes or from the...
Yes. Yeah. It's waiting for extra the best, because there are all kinds of nanoparticles where you have to use all these rare earth metals that are found in China, but that's first of all these are expensive and they need to make nanoparticles because they have emission at 1700 nanometers, but there are dyes already now that have already. Some good signals at around 1300 nanometers, but I think that needs to be improved. So I think it's all about chemistry now to find a better fluorescent dyes that emit at the higher wavelengths.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much, Mariana. So I just want to like to invite you all for next week, where after our regular virtual pub, where Andreas Walter will present on multimodal imaging across scales and facilities and present Austria bioimaging, we have an offer coming to you from the industry board. Some of our industry board companies will present their solutions, their technologies in multimodal imaging. And we will have short presentations from Leica, Zeiss, Visual Sonics, and Thermo Fisher straight after the virtual pub. And we would be happy if some of you would stay on. And I'm looking forward to exciting talks about technology then.
Yeah, it's nice to see that we work with some of these people.
Can I have a question? This will be the same address, just continuation of the previous one? Okay.
Yes.
You can just stay on or join it too if you have commitments before with this link.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay, great. Well then, thank you again to Professor Lübeck for a fantastic talk. This was very interesting. And Claudia already mentioned what we have on the program for next week, a presentation by Andreas Walter from Austria Bioimaging on multimodal imaging. And I think with that, we're at the end of the virtual pub today. Thank you all for joining us. And I wish you a nice afternoon and a great weekend. Stay safe, everybody.
Thank you.
Goodbye.
Thank you. Goodbye.
Bye.